Hello everyone and welcome to EBTV. Today it is my great pleasure to welcome special guest Gene Baur. Gene, hello and welcome.
Great to be with you, thanks.
You're very welcome. And for anyone who may be new to your work, Gene, I will just share a short introduction. Gene is an activist, co-founder, and president of Farm Sanctuary, the leading farm animal protection organization in the United States. For the past 30 years, he has been a pioneer and trailblazer in the area of compassionate living, animal welfare, and plant-based nutrition. Gene is also the author of Farm Sanctuary, Changing Hearts and Minds About Animals and Food, and Living the Farm Sanctuary Life, the Ultimate Guide to Eating Mindfully, Living Longer, and Feeling Better Every Day. And so the focus, Gene, for today's show and having, again, the pleasure to speak with you and share the beautiful message of hope, compassion, and respect for all species will be about just that, as EBTV is focused on helping people expand their consciousness on all sorts of topics and living from the heart. And so to get started, can you please share about your journey a little bit, especially that so many of us are going through various changes and not all of us and most of us have not been raised as, you know, having compassion for all animals or perhaps being raised as a vegan right from the start. So if you can share a little bit about how your journey started and got you to do the work that you do today.
Sure. Well, I certainly was not raised as a vegan. Most people grow up eating animal foods without really thinking about it. And that was the case with me. My parents, my brothers and sisters, everybody around me was eating meat. And it was just normal. You know, we didn't even question it. But there were many problems in the world that I didn't want to be part of, that I observed as I grew up. And I didn't want to be part of unnecessary violence. I didn't want to be part of destroying the environment. I didn't want to be part of causing unnecessary harm and suffering to other animals. And so in high school, I started getting involved with different nonprofits and, you know, human rights organizations. And my grandmother told me about how veal calves are raised. So that was my first sort of indication of the cruelty of factory farming. And I never ate veal, you know, because of that. Then my mother had, I remember, made a chicken dinner, and I saw this dead body on the plate with the legs and the wings, and he or she was on their back, you know, and I was clearly a dead animal, and I didn't eat meat that night or for parts of high school. But, you know, we are social animals. We are influenced by those around us. And as I went to college, started getting, you know, the old habits of eating animals, and that image of that dead bird faded from my memory. And but then in the early 1980s, I hitchhiked around the country, learned more about animal agriculture, learned more about the fact that it was possible to live well on a plant-based diet. And I thought, if I can live well without causing unnecessary harm, why wouldn't I? So I went vegan in 1985. Co-founded Farm Sanctuary in 1986, felt it was important to see firsthand what was happening, started going into farms and stockyards and slaughterhouses and seeing horrible things, started rescuing animals. And that was partly healing for us as well. It was there obviously to help take an animal off of a pile of dead animals, which was our first rescue, Hilda. You know, she was left on a pile of dead animals behind a stockyard. And, you know, you don't just leave a living creature on a dead pile. So we rescued her, and that helped to heal us as well, because seeing this horror time and time again can be pretty difficult. And I think we need hope. And that's really what Farm Sanctuary is about. It's about creating hope in the midst of this horror. And it's a place where the animals are our friends, not our food, where we get to enjoy positive relationships. And that's so I continue doing that work. I'm not on the farm doing the daily care anymore like I used to. I'm not cutting hay like I used to, which was kind of fun. But now I spend a lot of time traveling and just educating people about these issues and doing everything I can to raise awareness and to empower people to live more mindfully, more compassionately, in a way that is more connected with their own humanity and their own values and their own interests. To eat plants instead of animals is not only good for us in terms of our feelings and emotions, but biologically it's good for us. The earth is also negatively impacted by animal agriculture, so eating plants instead of animals is also good for the planet, and that's in our interest. So basically encouraging people to think about their food choices, make mindful choices, and live in a way that's aligned with their own values and interests.
Thank you for sharing that. And so many points there that I'd love to get into and explore a little bit deeper, because that's just it. And you share this so beautifully in the book, Living the Farm Sanctuary Life, when you shared, you know, despite my love for animals, it didn't occur to me not to eat them. And I find this is so true for so many people, right? We have such, you know, love and care, and we see how our dogs and cats get treated with such respect. And of course, we, you know, do all sorts of things for them. But when it comes to farm animals, for example, there seems to be a disconnect there. And so when you meet people, for example, and you teach and educate them about these very topics, how do you help them connect the dots to see that, you know, we're talking about beautiful living species, regardless if they're dogs, cats, cows, or pigs?
Yes. Well, I think most people are compassionate. Most people don't want to support unnecessary cruelty. So I start trying to identify the common ground. And most people agree that cruelty is, you know, a problem, and that if it's not necessary, that we shouldn't promote it. At the same time, though, you know, as you alluded to, most people are unwittingly supporting this horrible industry by eating meat, milk, and eggs, and that's been the norm. So we have this inconsistency between our compassionate values and our interests and our behavior, which is not aligned with our values or interests. So you find the common ground. So I often will talk about factory farming, and most people will say, I don't like factory farming. I wouldn't support that. And so I grab onto the common ground, say, we're on the same page with that. But then they will often say, I only buy humane animal products. And so with that, you know, there's this intention they have to do better. But you know, what is a humane animal product? And so I start asking that. So I'll hold on to the common ground saying, I'm really glad that we agree that factory farming is problematic, but I'm interested to know what, you know, what you think is humane farming, and what types of farms are these, and have you been to them? Because in most cases, people who say that haven't really thought very much about it. And I think a big part of advancing our cause is to encourage people to pay attention and to think about the consequences of their actions. And to say, I only get humane, is sort of a dismissal, really, of an investigation. So just asking questions, you know, will allow people to start thinking more about this. And that's my approach. And I think at the end of the day, that's, everybody has to make their own choice. But to encourage people to think, and then to really examine these issues, and then to make choices that they can feel good about, without sort of closing their eyes to the reality, I think is very important. And so when you start saying, for example, that in the case of free range, it doesn't require that these animals actually have a really good life, you know, and it sounds a lot better than it is. And so part of this is educating people about how these humane labels are misleading. And then at the end of the day, you kind of come to the fundamental question about whether the word humane and the word slaughter fit very well together. And, you know, I purposely word that in a way where it's not, I'm not saying meat is murder. I'm saying, think about this sentence and think about these words, the word humane and the word slaughter. Do they fit well together? And so that you look at it objectively, and I think it's pretty hard to make the case that the word humane and the word slaughter fit well together.
Exactly. And what you're doing essentially is really bringing these topics to our awareness, because again, as more and more of us know today, we operate daily out of pretty much our subconscious mind, our habits, our patterns. We don't really think consciously. We think we are, but we really aren't. And so to bring these topics to the awareness and to see, hey, you know, how do you feel about this? How does this fit for you? I think is extremely valuable. But ultimately, what it's all pointing to, and again, something that you alluded in your introduction, is that aspect of a shift in perspective. And this is so powerful, because this is, of course, what's going to make the longest, most long-lasting, sustainable change. And so when it comes to having a shift in perspective, especially given that you've been in this work for the past 30 years, have you seen, or how have you seen and experienced this taking place across the populations?
I'm seeing a massive shift, even in the last couple of years. Back in 1986, the idea of being vegan was very sort of foreign and frightening to people. People didn't even know what the term meant. They mispronounced the word. That still happens, but not nearly as much. And vegan food is much more widely available now than ever. So I think that, you know, human beings are very much creatures of habit, and we're also creatures of convenience. We like to see ourselves, and to some extent it's true that we are creatures of conscience, but not as much as we'd like to believe. I think we are oftentimes creatures more of convenience. And so the more vegan food that's available and accessible, I think the more likely it is that people are going to eat it. And there's more vegan food now than ever. You go to a mainstream grocery store and it's not only soy milk anymore, but there's coconut milk and almond milk and combinations of these things. And there's vanilla and there's original, there's sweetened, there's unsweetened, there's chocolate. There's all kinds of alternatives now to cow's milk. That's very positive. There's alternatives to meats from animals. There's veggie meatballs. There's veggie chicken cutlets. There's all kinds of things. So that's, I think, really helping to propel this movement and to normalize the idea of eating plants instead of animals. And at the same time, you have more awareness about the cruelty of factory farming and the abuses and how harmful it is to animals and the planet. And people generally would rather not support that. So as it becomes easier and as there is increasingly more awareness about these issues, you know, I'm seeing huge shifts. And the other thing is that vegan culinary arts have really advanced in recent years. I remember back in 1985 when I went vegan for soy milk, we'd often take a powder and water and mix them together for soy milk, you know. It was a lot harder back then. I remember making seitan myself with whole wheat flour and kneading it down into the protein. So now you can get all kinds of seitan or other plant-based foods at mainstream grocery stores. And it's, you have celebrities even now talking about being vegan. So it's kind of becoming cool, which is great, but it's also healthy. And, you know, when people eat well, they feel better physically. They feel better emotionally. They know they're not supporting this horrible system. It's a win, 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 you know. And at the end of the day, I think it's aligned with what most people want, and it's good for people. And we don't want to put anybody down. We want to elevate and inspire and encourage people to live well and according to the best of their humanity, which really is what this is about. And when you relate to animals in a positive way, it's good for the animals and it's good for us. And, you know, at Farm Sanctuary, the animals are our friends, not our food. We get to enjoy our lives with them. There's not this violence that occurs when they're being raised for food, whether it be in a factory farm or on a small farm. And it's just a much more beautiful kind of thing. And, you know, if you think about it, you know, most people would rather be at a sanctuary than at a slaughterhouse. Most people would rather be out in an open pasture with a beautiful environment than in one of these factory farms where you have animals in crates clanking against the bars, screaming to get out. The air so thick with toxic fumes that it makes you sick to go in there, makes your eyes burn and your throat burn. You know, that is not good for anybody. And so what we're talking about is a way of living, a way of relating to other animals that is essentially an aspiration to live as kindly as possible. And to me, that's what being vegan is. It's an aspiration to live as kindly as possible. None of us is perfect. We are human beings. Just living on this planet, we're going to cause harm. And to me, it's also not an ingredient list. You know, for instance, you know, I try to buy organic produce, but it could be grown with slaughterhouse byproducts like bone meal or blood meal or feather meal. And if it was an ingredient list, purchasing organic produce grown with, you know, such fertilizers would not technically be vegan. Or what about bees that are transported by the billions to pollinate nut trees in California, for example? Is that technically vegan or not? So to me, it's really an aspiration to continuously try to learn and to do better. And it's a process.
Oh, that's such an important point. Absolutely. Because it is true that, you know, sometimes people do get stuck in this, like, well, it's all or nothing approach, right? And then either go for this rigid perfection, which is really not realistic, or just forget the whole thing to begin with, right? And start citing all sorts of reasons why they should not even start trying. So this is very important to hear. And also, you know, as you share that, that's the thing, we are really good. And you share that so beautifully in your book through the ideas that inherently humans, of course, we are good and we want to do good, etc. But I find, especially from the nutrition perspective, so many people have this fear that can now be alleviated because, as you shared, there's so many food products. And from the nutrition perspective, there's just so much empowering information to say that we have nothing to worry about. There's more than enough protein. There's more than enough nutrients. And in fact, you're healthier and happier for it. And so from that perspective, then it seems to be an easy path. However, as you shared, you know, there are various challenges. And another one that I'd love to get your take on is, what about when you do teach or come across people who have the beliefs, or strong beliefs especially, that, well, animals were put on this planet to serve as food? How do you deal with that?
Yeah, that's one of those beliefs that is a challenge. And, you know, we grow up with beliefs. You know, there have been beliefs over the course of human history that we now look at and say, that's crazy. You know, we used to believe the earth was flat, and we used to believe the earth was the center of the universe. We used to believe that certain people belonged as slaves. We used to believe that women should not be allowed to vote. So there are a lot of beliefs that our society has held over the course of time. And as we evolve as a species, I think we start questioning some of these beliefs and then looking at them critically and evaluating whether or not they serve us well and whether or not they make sense. And, you know, while certain things may be perceived to serve the interests of certain power holders, really, if you really look deeply, they actually are not necessarily that good for even the power holders in the long term. So when it comes to animals being put here for us to use, I mean, that was said about certain people, that was, you know, over the course of our history, and I think it needs to be questioned and challenged. And just because it's a belief doesn't mean that it's correct. You know, we've had a lot of beliefs that were incorrect, and we've learned that in time. And I think this is another one that we will, in time, come to dismiss as unhealthy and cruel and unnecessary and not serving us well, not serving the planet well, not helping us to enjoy life as we could.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, you also mentioned the conditions that anyone, again, who does some research, never mind if they actually get a chance to visit a conventional factory farm, about the toxicity there, whether it's, you know, the waste products, the fumes, etc. And so, of course, there's the compassion to prevent the animals from ever needing to experience this or go through this. But something that sometimes isn't obvious to people is the humans who have to work there. And so can you talk a little bit about this? Because sometimes I find this is a point of connection that turns on that light bulb, like, okay, well, animal compassion is one thing. Maybe I'm not feeling as strongly about that. But what about the humans that technically my habits, my eating habits would be subjecting them to need to work in places like this?
No, absolutely. Working in slaughterhouses is very difficult. There's a high injury rate, very high turnover rate. There's physical injuries. There are also emotional injuries. Oftentimes, people that work in these places bring the violence of the slaughterhouse home. In communities where you have these types of animal agriculture factories, whether it be slaughterhouse or the farm, you know, you have community problems. You know, you have health care that's not adequate to meet the needs. You have people that are not paid very well and who are injured and don't have the support they need. So, you know, this is an industry that's bad for everybody. And, you know, I often ask people, you know, can you imagine what it would be like to work in a slaughterhouse where for 8 hours a day, your job is cutting the throats of animals? And, you know, sometimes people will say, I think somewhat flippantly, that, well, plants have feelings too. And to that, you know, there's a couple of responses. One is a very utilitarian response that, well, if you really care about plants, eating plants directly means you're going to cause far fewer to be killed, because raising animals for food requires us to feed them tons and tons of corn and soy and other plant foods. You're killing a lot more plants when you're eating animals. But the other kind of, I think, more human sort of response is to ask somebody to consider the different experiences they would have of going to a strawberry patch or an orchard and picking apples versus going to a slaughterhouse and watching animals having their throats cut and being bled and then cut up. They're two very different experiences. And I think that we are much more inclined towards the former, towards the plant-based one. And there's a quote I include in my book from an author who wrote a book a number of years ago. And he says, if you take a child and put him in a room with a rabbit and an apple, and if he eats the rabbit and plays with the apple, I'll buy you a new car. You know, and if we were natural carnivores, we would tend to salivate at the sight of dying, bleeding, injured animals. But we don't tend to do that. And so, you know, just because we have done something doesn't mean that we should continue doing it. You know, in the course of our history, there have been times when humans have eaten other humans. You know, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's a good thing to do. You know, over the course of our history, we've done a lot of things to survive. That, you know, if we have the choice, we would probably not do. And so raising animals or consuming animals has, you know, at certain times maybe been helpful in terms of human survival, just like eating humans from time to time has been. That doesn't mean it's the ideal. And if we have a choice and we can eat plants instead of animals, we can feed far more people. We can have more access to healthy food. We don't need to destroy nearly as much of the earth. We don't need to plow nearly as much land. We don't need to cut down rainforests for grazing and cropland. You know, we have much more resources that are not being squandered now, because that's what's happening with animal agriculture.
Yeah, and that's just it, is that, again, we've, especially here in North America, accepted this animal food-centric way of life as the norm, when in fact it is such a recent and modern development that, you know, what is considered normal today is actually far from it for our health, for our earth, etc. And something else that you brought up that I also teach about so much is that there's a big difference between surviving and thriving. And what was once done to survive is very different from what it takes to thrive. And today, again, especially in North America, we have the luxury, we are fortunate to start asking ourselves the question, what can we do to actually thrive and stop acting and behaving as if we're still in this survival mode? And so a little bit, though, about that, because you do also mention this in your book in terms of the fact that to also bring people the awareness of how unnatural it is to eat the animal, high animal-centric diet that is consumed in North America today. Can you touch a little bit upon that?
Yeah, well, if you look historically and at different types of ethnic foods, they are primarily plant-based, like Indian food or Ethiopian food or Mexican food or Chinese food or Thai food. This idea of eating a lot of animal products is a relatively recent occurrence, and it oftentimes is linked to wealth and power. And that's a whole other aspect of this, that, you know, those with many resources are in a position to appropriate those for their purposes, and eating meat is sort of symbolic of the high status and power of certain groups or individuals. So what we're suggesting here is that we kind of reshape this, and, you know, using a lot of resources, I don't think is something that we should aspire to. In fact, I think it's very harmful and very selfish and very disrespectful of others, humans and other animals. But in terms of the way we are eating, you know, as you say, we're eating a very high animal-based diet. We're eating a lot of processed foods, and we are suffering huge health problems as a result of it. It's been estimated that we could save something like 70% on healthcare costs by shifting to a whole foods plant-based diet. There's a movie called Forks Over Knives that I think makes the case very well, that I would suggest that people take a look at if they haven't seen it yet. And it's completely irrational when you look at it, that we eat food that makes us sick. Why do we do this? It's habits. You know, we grow up doing a thing a certain way and we assume that's the way it's supposed to be. But when we look at the facts and the empirical evidence and we start making more rational choices, where we can eat food that actually nourishes us and improves our health and helps us not only survive, but thrive, as you say, then we'll eat more plants instead of animal products. And I'll also say that in the vegan world, you know, I see these like meatless meats as very good transition foods, but truth is a lot of them are fairly processed. So that's not really the ideal thing to eat either. I think they are much better than eating a slab of animal product like cow flesh or chicken flesh or pig flesh or turkey flesh or whatever it is, but it's still a processed product. And eating whole foods like beans, for example, should really be the staple. I think those processed products are fine, but in moderation. And, this is where, again, it's not a black and white world. This is a process, and we take steps. And for people who are not vegan, who are interested, doing something like a meatless Monday, where one day a week they don't eat animal products. And that helps people become more comfortable with the idea of eating plant foods instead of animal foods, including possibly meatless meat products. But it's one of the biggest obstacles to change, I think, is fear. And, this fear that, oh, I'm not going to like the taste of it. That's really shifting. There's amazing vegan food now, so people can like the taste and really love the taste, in fact, of vegan foods. There's another fear that people aren't going to get enough protein. And that's a myth because, we get all the protein we need. In fact, we get too much protein in developed countries. So you get all the protein you need very easily. And then another myth, a belief, is that we need to drink cow's milk to get calcium so we don't get osteoporosis. This is completely untrue. If you look at countries like the US and Canada, where there's a lot of cow's milk consumed, we also have a lot of osteoporosis. So drinking cow's milk doesn't prevent osteoporosis the way we're told. So looking at these things and critically evaluating and questioning some of our assumptions and behaviors and beliefs is healthy. Unless we do that, we continue along the same unhealthy paths. And if we didn't question certain assumptions and beliefs and behaviors, slavery would still be normal, And so it's a matter of challenging assumptions. And that's a big part of what this is about. And there's so many great vegan foods now. It's never been easier.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, that's just it. It's about growth. It's about expansion. It's about questioning, right? It's about awareness rather than stagnating because we are afraid to look, what's the possibility that, could be so much and actually always is from so many angles as we've been talking about today, better for us, better for the animals, better for the earth. So win-win-win situation as we explore this dimension. And so I love that you're sharing the steps. That's a very powerful approach always, because again, it's not this all or nothing overnight kind of approach. And you share that throughout all of your work, which I love so much, is that there's actionable steps, right? That this is real, this is practical. What step can I take today to get me one step closer to being in alignment with my values, with my personal, standards, etc. But what about, sometimes too, I find that people do get take that first step and perhaps it become vegetarian. But then comes this period or, sometimes many years of stagnation where, oh, vegetarian is good enough. Can you help us understand a little bit more about what happens, especially when it comes to dairy farming or, chicken laying hens or egg laying hens, I should say? Because sometimes people do have the idea that, well, as long as the animal's not being killed, then it's good enough.
Yes. No, many people become vegetarian because they are concerned about animals and don't want to cause unnecessary suffering, and that's very good. But the dairy industry and the egg industry are perhaps even worse than the meat industry when it comes to animal suffering. In the case of dairy cows, for example, in order to produce milk, they have to have a calf. They don't lactate and produce milk just for the heck of it. They produce this milk for their baby. So, on dairy farms, the cows have a calf every year. The calf is taken away immediately after birth so that milk can then be sold for humans. The cows are hooked up to these milk machines 2 or 3 times a day, pushed to produce about 10 times more milk than normal. Their bodies are pushed to their biological limits, not only because they're producing so much milk, but because during most of their lactation period, they're also pregnant with their next calf because they have a calf every year and they have a 9-month gestation period. So, in a healthy environment, these cows could live 20 years. But on these farms where they're pushed so hard, they're sent to slaughter after about 3 years in production. And then they become beef. So, these dairy cows become beef cattle at the end of their life, which was difficult. And they've lived a longer, harder life than cows raised for beef. The other thing about the dairy industry is these. Male, the calves that are born to the cows, half of them are female and they're raised to become milking cows. They call them replacement heifers. The other half are male, and they're useless to the dairy industry. So the veal industry was actually created to take advantage of this plentiful supply of unwanted male calves born on dairy farms. So that's the dairy industry. It literally created the veal industry, which is literally born out of the dairy industry. And then the cows suffer terribly. And besides the physical suffering, there's the emotional turmoil that comes with having a calf, and cows are very maternal, like other animals, and the calf is taken away. And so there's this emotional stress for the mother and the baby, and then the physical stress as well. So that's dairy, and why, you know, drinking alternatives to cow's milk is much better than drinking cow's milk. It's cow's milk for a calf. You know, why don't we drink dog's milk or giraffe's milk or, you know, milks from other species? At a certain point, you know, we wean ourselves, you know, and we don't need milk anymore. Now, we grew up with the habit of it, and, you know, I still drink, you know, non-dairy milk in my coffee and on cereal and things like that, but we don't need to torture other animals for this. In the case of the egg industry, most hens that are producing eggs in North America live in what are called battery cages. They're lined up in rows, stacked in tiers in huge factory warehouses where the birds are packed so tightly they can't even stretch their wings. Their feathers routinely wear off from scraping against the bars constantly. And they'll live this way for about a year or 2 years. When they're no longer profitable and not laying enough eggs, they're called spent hens. And then they're killed. In some cases, they go to slaughterhouses to be used for low-grade chicken products, like for pot pies or chicken soup. In other cases, slaughterhouses don't even want them because they're so skinny and they're so beat up that they will just be killed, sometimes thrown in landfills, sometimes ground up alive. And that is what these egg-laying hens ultimately experience. And then the other issue with the egg industry is that you have the unwanted male chicks that hatch at the hatchery. There are two distinct breeds of birds now exploited in developed countries. There are the meat-type birds who have been genetically bred to grow twice as big and twice as fast as normal. They have a lot of meat on them. They go to slaughter like 6 or 7 weeks old, very young. And they grow so fast, by the way, that they die of heart attacks at just a few weeks old because their hearts and lungs can't support that growth rate. But they're raised by the billions, so they can afford to lose hundreds of millions every year, which is insane. But that's the kind of numbers we're talking about. And then the other type of chicken are the egg-laying hens, who've been genetically altered to produce a lot of eggs, but they don't grow very fast or very large. So at the hatchery that hatches these egg-laying hens, you have the males and the females. The females are raised to become egg layers. The males are useless to the egg industry. They don't grow fast enough to be raised profitably for meat, so they're killed on the day they hatch. And I've been to these places and I've seen dumpsters full of these unwanted male chicks chirping, you know, dead and dying. I've seen unwanted male chicks thrown into a manure spreader alive to be spread on the field like manure. So that's a whole nother side effect of the egg industry, is these unwanted male chicks who are thrown away. And then you have the laying hens that are exploited for a year or two and then they are killed. And so they arguably have it worse than animals raised for meat because they live longer, they live in horrible conditions. And, you know, like all animals exploited for food, they're basically seen as commodities or as production units, not as living, feeling creatures. And that's sort of the fundamental question. What is our relationship with these other animals? Are they fellow earthlings that we want to treat with respect? Or are they raw materials to be exploited with no regard for their own feelings and their own interests? And that's really the fundamental question. And I think most people would rather not cause unnecessary suffering, don't like to see others in pain and misery. And there's so much more too. I mean, there's like these hens, for example, are de-beaked. They have parts of their beaks cut off. And that goes for so-called free-range farms and organic farms as well. So this is, you know, as when the relationship is one of commodification as opposed to companionship, then there are likely going to be problems.
Exactly. And that's, again, where it comes in, that shift in perspective. How do we see these animals? How do we see ourselves in relationship to their animals, to the animals? Because, again, it's it's so easy to, out of sight, out of mind, have somebody else do the dirty work for us, right? But at the end of the day, this is what it's about. It's about the education, the awareness, and then saying, what do I choose? Because it is all a choice. And so you've decided to make, again, a beautiful choice for yourself personally, but also a choice that then has influenced the lives of millions of people on Earth in terms of how they can approach these topics and live in a more aligned, compassionate way. And so everything we've been talking about, of course, is like night and day difference of what happens at the farm sanctuary. You touched a little bit upon that. Can you tell us, give us an overview of the farm sanctuary, especially as it relates to specifically its mission, values, and vision?
Yeah, well, farm sanctuary is a place where vegan is normal, where the animals are our friends, not our food, and where we get to interact with them in a very positive way. And, you know, like people live with cats and dogs, we live with cows and pigs and chickens and turkeys and goats and sheep and animals who had been discarded by an industry in some cases, or who are, you know, thrown away. And so there's a transformation that happens for the individual animals and also for people when they see that kind of relationship. So a big part of what we do at Farm Sanctuary is model a different kind of relationship. And you start seeing sheep, for example, who like to be petted. So when you stop petting them, they'll paw at you saying, keep petting me. We have 500-pound pigs that'll flop over for belly rubs. And it's a beautiful, beautiful thing to see. And that's good for the animals, and it is good for us. You know, in my book, Living the Farm Sanctuary Life, I talk about one of the tenets of living this lifestyle, which is to engage in a mindful relationship with other animals. And science has shown that this actually helps human health as well as animals. It helps reduce stress, reduce our heart rates and high blood pressure issues. So there are benefits to this kind of relationship, and that's what Farm Sanctuary is about. It's about modeling a compassionate way of living. So we advocate vegan living, and we think this is best for animals, for the earth, and for ourselves. And we also have an organizational value that is that we speak to people where they are on their own journeys. Each of us is on our own path, but we each make choices every day. And I believe that people can be empowered to make choices that are inspiring to them and actually good for them. And that's another whole part of this, is that when you live in a way that is aligned with your values and interests, it's just much healthier. And there's Pepe making some noise. So at Farm Sanctuary, the animals get to enjoy their lives, and we also get to enjoy their lives. And by enjoying their lives, it also enhances our lives. They're part of this planet, and so are we. And when we relate to them in a positive way, it benefits all of us.
Yes, and that's the thing. You know, we've been talking about, for example, the physical health benefits and the compassion benefits and such. But on an emotional and mental level, there are benefits here that go so above and beyond, you know, even what we've touched upon here. But it's just immense in terms of the energetic output, the you know, emotional output that is given via all the violence, perhaps, versus via the peaceful approach that we can each have. And at the end of the day, again, it is so beneficial for us and for our personal healing and living.
The great thing about this, too, is that each of us has control over what we eat. There's many things in this world that we cannot do very much about, and it can be very disturbing to see sort of the violence and the prejudice that continues in many, many places. But when it comes to what we eat, each of us every day has a lot of control over that, and we can make choices that can make a big difference for ourselves and for others. And that's one of the biggest pluses, is just how empowering this is and how collectively we can have a massive impact. In the U.S., over the past 10 years or so, the number of animals being slaughtered annually has gone down by about 500 million.
Wow.
And it's because people are shifting towards eating more plants and fewer animal products. Now, we still have a long way to go. In the U.S., there are still about 9 billion farm animals raised and slaughtered every year. But it had gotten up to about 10 billion. So we're starting to make progress. We're starting to go in a good direction. And collectively, when people start making more thoughtful, mindful choices, it has massive economic impacts. And so by just going and buying veg at a farmer's market, we vote with our dollars, we support a different kind of food system, we enable it, instead of giving money to this industry that's torturing animals, destroying the planet, and harming our own health. I mean, it's kind of a no-brainer when you think about it, but we have these habits, and we also have it within our power to change. And you know, it's been said that the only constant is change. And you know, our brains and our behaviors are very much patterns. I remember hearing a brain expert on either the Jon Stewart with Daily Show or Stephen Colbert, one of those two shows, and he was asked to describe brain function in 5 words. And he said, nerve cells fire in patterns. So we have these patterns, and sometimes they become ruts. And sometimes it takes a sort of major event like a heart attack to kind of slap us out of our rut. But, you know, if we think about it and act rationally and in alignment with our values, we can start taking steps right now to choose plants instead of animals, and that could make a world of difference.
Exactly. And I'm glad too that you pointed out the aspect of the economy, right? Because I'm sure you've come across this many times, and you should talk about this actually in your book. When people kind of say, but if all this meat and dairy industry or farming stopped, then so many people would be out of a job. What do you share about that?
Well, if you look at the course of human history, there have been a number of institutions and businesses that are no longer significant. I mean, slave owning, for example, and the whole slave trade business was something that is no longer, well, still happens, but it's not really an institution that's admired and supported. You know, buggy whip manufacturers are not around anymore now that we have cars. So things change. And people change, and it's all part of evolution, you know. And there are new opportunities for people who want to grow food in a more sustainable way that is less of a strain on the planet and is healthier for consumers. And there is, in addition to the whole factory farming side of things, there is another wave now of young people and people that have worked in cities that are just tired of that. Growing food, moving to suburban or rural areas, or even in urban areas. There's urban farming happening now. So there's this movement, this grassroots movement, and interest in promoting and producing healthy food. And so it's an exciting time from that standpoint. The number of farmers markets are expanding, the number of community-supported agriculture programs and community gardens are expanding. Urban farming is growing. There's a food not lawns movement where people are ripping up their lawns and planting vegetables. Churches sometimes have these, you know, gardening spots at their locations. So there's a movement now, and it's because people are hungry for healthy food and for community. And that, you know, the word food, comida, the Spanish word, has the same root as community, getting together around a table. Breaking bread and eating together in a healthy way is so energizing and empowering and positive. And people want that, and it's happening. So that gives me a lot of hope. And you also have vegan restaurants and vegan companies, entrepreneurs that are out now producing incredible vegan food. And it's never been so good. So there's a lot of really great things happening, and it's not that hard now to find vegan food, whether at a restaurant or at a supermarket or online even. And I think getting together with like-minded people and having like these vegan dining clubs is very positive, where you go out to a local restaurant, for instance, make sure they know there's 10 or 15 or 20 or 5 or 2 vegans coming, and then the restaurant will be sure to have vegan food. And that becomes part of this education process where the restaurant now knows that there's this market. And it's people getting together for a nice night out. So there's these kinds of things too that are, I think, very positive. And because we are social animals and we are influenced by those around us, this type of activity, I think, is supportive of a mindful, healthy way of eating and living, not only food, but in community. And then making food together, that's another thing, is, you know, people have sort of lost the interest in cooking and will go buy something. You know, have people over and make a meal together. That can be fun. You know, open a bottle of wine, put on some music, and cut veggies and talk. You know, that's okay. You know, so that's another thing that can happen here culturally, is where people come together around food and around cooking and around enjoying meals together and enjoying each other's company instead of just looking at the iPhone all the time.
Yeah, very, very, very important points, and especially that aspect of community and support, which we really are craving more than ever today. And that's what also will help to make this journey sustainable, because as you pointed out, that social aspect for sure is there. We're very influenced by others. So the more that we do cultivate a supportive community network, the more likely this is going to be a real part of our lives. And so thank you so much for sharing that. And, the other aspect too that you mentioned about the growing our own food and making our own food and coming back to the kitchens, this is also such a healing part of us. And as you share in the five tenets of farm sanctuary living, of becoming mindful and having a mindful relationship with our food. And it's not just dealing with animals, but it is with plants, with just how we prepare our food, how we eat it, right? That it's not something grabbed in mad rush and disconnection all around. So thank you so much for that, Jean. And a question that I have to ask you is, especially as a male, because of course we talked about how, especially in North America, it's a very animal-centric diet. And although there are many males and females, opening up their hearts and going with a more compassionate way of life towards all creatures and species, but it's no surprise that for males, there's still the stigma, like, what, a life without meat, right? How do you help, especially males, sort of bring peace to this topic and actually open up to this?
Yeah, well, we are social animals and we are socialized to supposedly play certain roles. And I think what's helped recently is that you have some elite athletes who are men and who are vegan, who are showing that you can get all the protein you need to be very strong. There's this vegan strongman who broke a world record carrying more weight than any human had ever carried, and he's doing this all on plant power. So examples like that, I think, demonstrate that, this isn't a wimpy way of eating, because that's kind of the assumption that it's weak, but that's completely incorrect. And you can also talk about some of the strongest animals on the planet, elephants, for example, who are plant eaters. And in addition to strength, you have elite athletes like Scott Jurek, who's won the Western States 100-mile race 7 times in a row. He's won the 150-something-mile Spartathlon in Greece as a vegan. So you have endurance athletes. Carl Lewis, the Olympic gold medalist, did his best times on a vegan diet. So pointing those things out, I think, helps to dispel these myths people have and these beliefs people have that eating plants is not somehow powerful, when in fact, it can give us everything we need and, in fact, do so better than animal products.
And I think it helps men too to open up to that wholeness of their being, right? To recognize that it's okay to feel emotions, right? And it's okay to open up to compassion and love and take a stand also in terms of their personal choices and be a leader, right? Perhaps amongst their friends, etc. So thank you so much for that. And one last question that I'd love to ask you is, having been in this work for, again, about 30 years now, and having seen no doubt the best and worst of humanity, how do you keep your personal level of hope and compassion alive for our human family?
Yeah, as you say, doing this work, you do see the best and the worst of humanity. And so you need to deal with the bad stuff. You can't brush it under the carpet and say it doesn't exist. But, for me, I don't dwell in that. I'm aware of it. I'm able to talk about it and raise awareness about it and educate people about it because most people don't think enough about it. But hammering that ugliness over and over turns people off. They don't want to see it. So I try to dwell in the positive and try to, provide examples and support for small steps in a more positive direction. And I also take heart when I see anybody taking any steps in a positive direction. So if somebody tells me they don't eat veal, for example, I'll say that's great, because it's a small step, but it's going in a good direction, and small steps tend to lead to more steps. So I try to dwell in the positive. I try to focus on and then be inspired by the good things that are happening. And there's a lot of really amazing things happening.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, thank you so much for sharing that. And so, for anyone who may be wondering, okay, so how can I perhaps visit the farm sanctuary? Can you give us a little bit of information, both in person, how they can do this, and also what's the best place online?
Yeah, well, our website is farmsanctuary.org, and there's information there about visiting our farms in New York and California, and also getting involved in other ways. And so I'd encourage people to go there and spread the message. Share online information with your friends, share pictures, share you know, let people know about these issues, because one of the big problems is people just don't think about this enough. And so as people start thinking about it, recognizing that they can be empowered to live more compassionately and more healthfully, most are going to want to do it, I think.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And so your books are also available on Amazon, as well as all major online retailers, as well as some perhaps local bookstores and libraries. And of course, the Farm Sanctuary has a presence all throughout social media, so you can connect with Farm Sanctuary and follow their work there as well. Gene, thank you so incredibly much for being here with us today, sharing what you have, but most importantly, for having, you know, the courage and the love and compassion within yourself to do the work that you are doing.
Thank you very much. I feel very fortunate to do something I believe in, and I'll keep plugging away.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you again, and thank you everyone for joining us today. If you have any questions, comments, or feedback, please feel free to leave them in the comment section below. Until next time.